In the book of Revelation, we have a revelation of the worship of heaven. The 24 elders fell down before him who sits on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, "You are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they exist and were created." That our worship this evening may be a bit of heaven, may we receive the Lord's blessing, that is the blessing of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Ghost, that we may worship him aright, receive his blessing. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen. Let's continue in our worship in song number 308. And here is a hallelujah of the last psalm of the Psalter in the Bible, Psalm 150. Hallelujah, praise ye God. And again, considering the example of the worship of heaven, let us be praying as we sing and as we praise God, that God would show us a bit of the blessings of heaven. The three stanzas, 308. With that song now of praise in our hearts, let's now recite the articles of our Christian faith with a true and living faith, and as I said, a singing faith, resolute, that we're going to show forth the praises of God, not only in what we say, but in how we live. Let's now recite what God has revealed to us in His Word of the Christian faith. I believe in God the Father, Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit. I believe a holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's continue our worship in song number 169, which is, I believe, a versification of what's been called the Psalm of the Covenant, Psalm 89, and where the psalmist records the mercies, the covenant mercies of the Lord that are forever unchanging, and he is here singing with all his heart of what God has revealed to him of the great salvation that is in Jesus Christ, and so we should. 1, 2, and 3 of 169. It is simply delightful to be in the house of God again, and have the freedom of the land. We're thankful for that. In America, we have these laws that are safeguards for our liberty, and we're glad that we can have them, at least at this point in the history of our country. We're so glad as well for the compunction of the Holy Spirit, the movement in our souls so that we freely come. Not forced, but we freely come. And children, though your parents are insisting that you come, nevertheless, we trust that you want to come to church to hear about Jesus and to sing the songs with us. We're so glad that you can pray with us too and you can confess your faith with us too. It's a great and delightful thing. As a family, we come together. We're glad to have visitors to the family. And we're glad for the opportunity that you can hear God's word, maybe some for the first time, maybe some listening in, and because these services are broadcast. And you never know the seeds that are sown and the harvest that God will give as the word of God goes forth from this pulpit. May God bless us then. It's a delightful thing, I say, to be in the house of God. And as we believe, this is a foretaste of heaven. Let's pray. Our Lord, in heaven, we pray that you would condescend to be with us tonight. Come down in your spirit and word and speak to us and whisper to us the wonderful things that you would show of the gospel, for that's the message you have, the good news that is in your Son, that there is life in him, that there is wonderful blessings that earth cannot afford in him, and in him and through faith in him, we go to heaven. Without him and without faith in him, we are yet in our sins, and we are bound for hell. We do pray, Lord, that you would bless us then and assure us tonight. You are here, come down from heaven's height, and yet still God. Here, our friend, and yet still our holy friend, who is our God and Father and friend. Here, befriending sinners, and yet without any compromise of your righteousness. Here, coming alongside and putting your arm around us and embracing us in our difficulties of life, and always assuring us that you are with us, even through the thick and the thin, in all of life, because you have ordained certain ways, and they're all good, all according to your counsel, all causing you to get the glory and the praise, even through the things of sinners and tyrants and bad people. You are the good God who is the King over all. We pray to acknowledge that you are King tonight, King of the whole church, world without end, of every nation, tribe, and tongue, every nationality, every ethnicity. Oh, you are such a great God of grace that way, Lord. You don't pick and choose in respect to persons, as if there's some who merit more than others. As we've heard this morning, none of us merits anything with you. And if we would brag about our own accomplishments, we have only to brag before men, nothing to brag about before you. This humbles us, Lord, but it reminds us of the freeness and greatness of your grace and what we're here about tonight. Whether we're in the congregation, whether we're in another church maybe visiting tonight, whether we're in no church, whether we're not even sure of whether we believe or not, Lord, this is the place to be. You've guided us here. You make no mistake. We're going to sit. We're going to listen. We're going to participate, Father, as we are led. And we do pray, lead us aright. So may there be no two-facedness here, no hypocrisy, no faking. May our religion be real. May our motives be pure. We're here not to please people, but the living God. May it be, Lord, that we are resolute in our repentance, real in confessing that our sins are great and many, and we are the ones who deserve your condemnation. Lord God, we pray, have mercy upon us. Remember us for Jesus' sake. And if we're doubting, if we're wondering, if we're vacillating about truth and the things revealed in the Bible that others say are true, we pray, convict us of that truth of your word, which is truly true, which is timelessly true, and also very timely in its truth. And so, Father, we have this eternal word amongst us, your living word, your Son, and also the written word in the Bible. As we open it, Lord, once again, and expound from the sacred history of Abraham and your dealings with him, may our ears be open to what we would hear. And may, Lord, it be for practical Christianity, piety, that we may adorn the doctrines of God and godliness with godliness, and with gracious demeanor and renewed words and beautiful prospects of life and great hope. We pray for each and every one here of the congregation that you would continue to bless us. Bless, Lord, the leaders of this church, the elders, the pastor, and the deacons, and the consistory as it meets in its regular meeting, very important meeting as always in the days of this week. Bless, we pray, them in their wisdom, in their counsel, in their being pastors to the flock. We pray your blessings so that the deacons may know the mercy of Christ and shed this mercy abroad in the congregation among the needy. We pray ourselves, Lord, to remember that there's an office we all hold as believers in Jesus, the officers that represent Him who is prophet and priest and king. And so in what we say, in how our lives are consecrated to the will of God, and in how we act righteously, may we reflect Your Son. Everyone, dignitaries from heaven, the Christian nobility, the Bereans who search the Scriptures to see even if apostles' speeches are true and confirm it for themselves and one another when it is true. And God, we pray then may we be that way here and show our nobility especially as a people of the Word. May the Word of God we love, Lord, may it dwell in us richly. May we speak to one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs and the great truths of the faith. May we be those who are digging deep, who are doctrinal, who are those who love the Reformed faith, the faith of our fathers living still that You have given and renewed among the churches in the Protestant Reformation. We ask, Lord, in this world to be those who are not of it, witnesses, that we can draw others to Christ and bring them to the means of grace so that they can sit at Jesus' feet and be powerfully moved by that awesome proclamation of truth from heaven through a mere man. May it be, Lord, that others are gathered to our midst this way who are real, sincere, pious, godly Christians. And, Lord, whatever the need, whatever the background, wherever they are at now, we pray, may grace find them, meet them, and not merely halfway, but all the way, even into the pit of hell, to bring them into the glorious communion of the Holy Ghost. We ask, Lord, Your blessing upon our world, that Your church may be gathered from it, that we, Lord, may be standing strong together, shoulder to shoulder, heart to heart, linked in the battle of faith. May the church be gathered from our midst, Lord, first of all, in the covenant youth, as we are using the means of grace and as fathers are leading the way, and as we hear tonight, as there's godly marrying in Jesus Christ. We do pray, Father, that You would bless so that the mission work of the church is something that doesn't just creep along, but is vigorous and zealous. And it comes from hearts, and it comes from individuals who are pricked by the Word of God, and who tell others, their neighbors, come and see this Jesus I know, and hear the Word that He speaks. Lord, may it be then that churches and federations and the whole church worldwide are engaged in this gathering of the Son of God's people that He has purchased on Calvary. So may that be the work that we see in and through even all the evil of men. Save, Lord, the evil and those who call themselves good. Save, Lord, because we're all in need of the blood of Jesus. Save so that there is a people that recognizes that the King of Kings lives and the Lord of Lords lives. And as the church says, He is coming again. May there be an urgency, Lord, about the church's mission. May we not omit the great commission to go into the world. May we be, Father, those who are full of grace, full of the virtues of heaven, full of the self-sacrifice that says, no matter what the cost, even if it be my life, I will live for Jesus. Lord, hear our prayers for the young, for the old, and the in-between, for the sinners and the saints, for all, Lord, who are in need of You constantly and Your daily forgiveness. Give us to be a praying people, truly a covenantal people, friends of God, not of the world. And hear us, we pray, and we are confident that You will hear in the full pardon of sins. For Jesus' sake, amen. Your offering at this time for the general fund of the church will be received. Thank you. Let's sing now from the hymnal 483, Come Ye That Fear Jehovah. Let's sing just the first two stanzas, 1 and 2 of 483. In what shall be the last of a series of sermons on Abraham, I would turn with you now to the Word of God, recording the sacred history of Abraham, Genesis 24. Genesis 24 records one of the last recorded events of Abraham's wife. He's old now. Over well advanced in age, we're told in the Bible here, some 40 years after Sarah died, so he must be about 140 years old. He will live 35 more years or so, and so he has a lot more living to do, but there's not a lot recorded of what he does in those years, but this is. And that is the seeking of a wife for his son and the son of the promise, and that is Isaac. And here this is recorded, one of the longest recordings of one episode in the Bible, and this for our learning and edification of the gospel and of our living for today. So we're going to read here from Genesis 24, but time constrains me. I can't read the whole of the 67 verses, so what I'm going to do is read the first 28 verses and then the last 7 or so to set before us the outcome of Abraham's pursuit of a bride for Isaac. So the first 28 verses, I'll read that, and then I'll explain a little bit what goes on between the verses we stop at and the verses we pick up at the end. But hear the word of God. Now Abraham was old, well advanced in age, and the Lord had blessed Abraham in all things. So Abraham said to the oldest servant of his house who ruled over all that he had, please put your hand under my thigh, and I will make you swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and the God of the earth, that you will not take a wife for my son from the daughters of the Canaanites among whom I dwell. But you shall go to my country and to my family and take a wife for my son Isaac. And the servant said to him, perhaps the woman will not be willing to follow me to this land. Must I take your son back to the land from which you came? But Abraham said to him, beware that you do not take my son back there. The Lord God of heaven, who took me from my father's house and from the land of my family, and who spoke to me and swore to me, saying, to your descendants I give this land, he will send his angel before you, and you shall take a wife for my son from there. And if the woman is not willing to follow you, then you will be released from this oath. Only do not take my son back there. So the servant put his hand under the thigh of Abraham, his master, and swore to him concerning this matter. Then the servant took 10 of his master's camels and departed, for all his master's goods were in his hand. And he rose and went to Mesopotamia, to the city of Nahor. And he made his camels kneel down outside the city by a well of water at evening time, the time when women go out to draw water. Then he said, O Lord God of my master Abraham, please give me success this day and show kindness to my master Abraham. Behold, here I stand by the well of water, and the daughters of the men of the city are coming out to draw water. Now let it be that the young woman to whom I say, please let down your pitcher that I may drink, and she says, drink, and I will also give your camels a drink, let her be the one you have appointed for your servant Isaac. And by this I will know that you have shown kindness to my master. And it happened before he had finished speaking. Let me read that. And it happened before he had even finished speaking, that behold, Rebekah, who was born to Bethuel, son of Milcah, the wife of Nahor, Abraham's brother, came out with her pitcher on her shoulder. Now the young woman was very beautiful to behold, a virgin, no man had known her. And she went down to the well, filled her pitcher, and came up. And the servant ran to meet her and said, please let me drink a little water from your pitcher. So she said, drink, my lord. Then she quickly let her pitcher down to her hand and gave him a drink. And when she had finished giving him a drink, she said, I will draw water for your camels also until they have finished drinking. Then she quickly emptied her pitcher into the trough, ran back to the well to draw water, and drew for all his camels. And the man, wondering at her, remained silent so as to know whether the Lord had made his journey prosperous or not. So it was, when the camels had finished drinking, that the man took a golden nose ring weighing half a shekel and 2 bracelets for her wrists weighing 10 shekels or shekels of gold, and said, whose daughter are you? Tell me, please, is there room in your father's house for us to lodge? So she said to him, I am the daughter of Bethuel, Milcah's son, whom she bore to Nahor. Moreover, she said to him, we have both straw and feed enough and room to lodge. Then the man bowed down his head and worshipped the Lord. And he said, blessed be the Lord God of my master Abraham, who has not forsaken his mercy and his truth toward my master. As for me, being on the way, the Lord led me to the house of my master's brethren. So the young woman ran and told her mother's household these things. Now what follows after in the narrative, and I would urge you to read this afterwards, alone or by families, what follows is the announcement of this man, this mysterious man of Abraham who's come to visit the house by Rebekah. And then the servant of Abraham goes and rehearses just exactly what had happened at the well, and the will of Abraham, and that this is evidently the hand of God. And then there's this recognition by Bethuel, Rebekah's father, and Laban, her brother, of indeed what God had done here. They acknowledge that this is the hand of God. And then after that, there's this willing submission to the will of God as well by Rebekah. And she goes and she herself is wed to Isaac. And those are the last verses. And let me read them for you, verses 61 and following. Then Rebekah and her maids arose. This is after it's revealed to them. This is God's will here, the providence of God, a miracle here, leading them together. And after Rebekah has said, I will go. Then Rebekah and her maids arose, and they rode on the camels and followed the man, the servant. So the servant took Rebekah and departed. Now Isaac came from the way of Beer Lahairoi, for he dwelt in the south. And Isaac went out to meditate or pray in the field in the evening. And he lifted his eyes and looked, and there the camels were coming. Then Rebekah lifted her eyes, and when she saw Isaac, she dismounted from her camel. For she had said to the servant, who is this man walking in the field to meet us? And the servant said, it is my master. So she took a veil and covered herself. And the servant told Isaac all the things that he had done. Then Isaac brought Rebekah, into his mother Sarah's tent. And he took Rebekah, and she became his wife, and he loved her. So Isaac was comforted after his mother's death. Thus far we read the narrative of Abraham even God, whom Abraham represents, getting a wife for Isaac. Now, here we are at the last of a series of sermons on Abraham, and we would be remiss if we didn't recount all that the Lord has been telling us of the wonderful history that's recorded in Genesis here, such a large part of the history of Genesis. Here we have, as we've seen in Abraham, especially three things of note, three outstanding things of Abraham. And number one, he is God's covenant man. He's a man with whom God has to do as a friend to a friend. And God calls him out of Ur to be his friend. He calls him from idols to serve the living God. And he befriends him, and he promises to be his God, and that Abraham would be his son, his child, and that Abraham would be a blessing to the nations, and that there would be this innumerable seed in the land of promise that would be given to him. In fact, the whole world would be blessed in and through Abraham and his seed. And so Abraham represents in this history an advancement of God's way of dealing with people. He is, in fact, in the Old Testament, the covenant man par excellence. And you can read of that in Genesis 12, Genesis 15, Genesis 17. God makes covenant. He makes a relationship of friendship with Abraham. He makes promises to Abraham. He obliges Abraham to certain obligations there. And it's a wonderful, wonderful saving relationship. And so Abraham stands out in that way. In fact, the covenant with Abraham is a picture of the eternal and everlasting covenant that God makes with us and his people, as we have seen and as we shall see. The second thing about Abraham, another C, he's a Christ man. He's a man who believes in Jesus Christ. That's one of the significances of Abraham's building altars when he gets to the promised land. He responds by worshiping. He builds altars, and no doubt he offers sacrifices there. They knew about sacrifices even before the laws of sacrifices were given to the sons and the daughters of Abraham and the generations of Israel. So Abraham was sacrificing, meaning he believed in the way of the blood, the only way to please God, and the way that Jesus himself would be on the cross of Calvary. It's no wonder as well that the last thing that we saw of Abraham, he was sacrificing Isaac on Mount Moriah, remember that? And he all but sacrificed him and received him, as it were, risen from the dead. So real was this faith sacrifice of Abraham. But there on Mount Moriah was the ram, that male sheep caught in the thicket, and Abraham was seeing Christ all over the place, wasn't he? In fact, that may be the event to which Jesus refers in John 8, I believe it is, when he says, Abraham rejoiced to see my day. Now, we can't put this all together so well. How in the Old Testament did they know Jesus? Well, when the New Testament, however, confirms to us that this is so, we believe this. And Abraham is this man of faith, so that we know that we're linked to him. And our link, our joining together with him, is in Christ Jesus. That's so beautiful. And that leads to the third point about Abraham. First, he's a covenant man, a man of God's fellowship, standing outside the Canaanites, even outside of this world, though he's in it, as one who's with God. Second, he's this man who knows the way to this fellowship and this covenant. It's all about Jesus. Third, he's a man of credo. And I say this word because I need another C. I want you to remember this. He's a covenant man, he's a Christ man, he's a credo man. That means he's a believer. We have a creed, it's something we believe. To say credo is to say I believe. Abraham's all about this. And in fact, he's set forth for us in the New Testament as the outstanding man of faith who is justified by his faith apart from his works. That's the book of Romans, referring to Genesis 15, verse 6. As well, Abraham is this man of faith who demonstrates his faith. He's not just saying, I believe. He's not just a young person who's been through the catechism and who says, well, I believe and I know what it's all about. And he goes out and lives like a devil. Abraham is a man who is true to his faith, who is uncompromised in his confession, though he's not perfect, and who walks the talk, as we say. And so James, the Apostle James in James 2, sets forth Abraham, who says he is the one who displays his faith. And this Abraham is for us a father, the Bible says, a veritable father of believers, so that we can follow in his example. So in all these things, Abraham, the covenant man, Abraham, the man of Christ, Abraham, the cradle, the believing man, we're seeing this outstanding person in the Bible. But let's not forget that also in Abraham, we see God. There's a wonderful picture in Abraham of God Almighty on this earth. It's awesome to see this, but here it is, and also displayed as we see Abraham fulfilling responsibilities, covenantal responsibilities, as a believer and getting a wife for Isaac. So let's look for these things. Let's look for covenant. Let's look for Christ. Let's look for the faith of Abraham displayed here, all in the marrying of his son, so vital for the continuation of the covenant and the fulfillment of the promise, vital for us today. A wife for Isaac. Let's consider, first of all, the piety, the family piety of Abraham here. He's a father of believers, and he's a father of Isaac. And he's a father of the nations, and so he is this one who shows family piety. Secondly, we want to consider the divine provision here. This is such a wonderful display of God's miraculous way of providing for a wife for Isaac, miraculously, but also through the prayers and the sanctified walk of Abraham and his servant. And then finally, last point, blessed assurance. And I'll get to that when I get to that. First point, Abraham, example of family piety. And he is. So pious, he's old, Sarah's gone, he's buried Sarah in the land of promise, and he seeks a wife for Isaac. Just going to list a certain number of ways in which he shows he is pious here. He's holy. Number one, he's seeking a wife for Isaac because it's the revealed will of God that Isaac have a wife. Well, in so many words, it's revealed. God has already said to Abraham repeatedly that there's going to be nations who come from you, Abraham, and that would mean they come from you by a miraculous birth of Isaac, and then through Isaac, and there's no question about it, through Isaac marrying and having children, so that all the nations, a multitude of believers, come from him and his union, and even in them, all the nations are blessed. So that's what he's doing here. He's not presuming upon the will of God. In fact, the will of God sometimes is that people be single. And we have to wrestle with that even in our own lives for however long that is. But Isaac is known to be one who needs to be married. And now he's about 40 at this time, and certainly a good age for marrying, as good as any. And Abraham now takes his servant and calls him to go on the mission. Abraham himself, for some reason, doesn't go on the mission. He doesn't send Isaac either. Now that's curious, and commentators have wondered, why doesn't Isaac go and find a bride for himself? It could be that Abraham's worried with parental worry that Isaac, when he goes looking for a mate, might compromise and might not find the right one, or might stay out of the land of promise. We don't know what is in the mind of Abraham here. But he sends his eldest servant, a trusted servant. That could be Eliezer, but we're not told here whose name the servant is. Well, another way that Abraham shows his piety here, his family piety, is that Isaac may not have a bride from the Canaanites. Now, there were no doubt some pious Canaanites. You have Melchizedek, and we don't really know where he came from. But there were others as well who might have been godly people. But that whole race of the Canaanites, you recall, was cursed. And they're filling up their cup of iniquity. They had the sodomite nature in them. And not only that, all of us have that by nature, but they were of the race that God had cursed through the pronouncement of Noah long ago in his curse upon the sons of Ham. So Abraham knows here that it's the will of God that he marry in the Lord. Something very important here, that Isaac marry someone in the Lord. Now, even then, he could not be assured of that when he sends Isaac, or the servant of Isaac, back to his own land and to the sons of Shem. But what Abraham is doing here is he is going forth in faith and sending his servant forth to a people among whom God had made the promise that there's going to be blessing among you, the Shemites, Abraham's relatives back in Haran, from which Abraham had come. They are the chosen race, and now Abraham has been chosen out of those general Shemites, and he is the one in whom the blessing will be. But he knows that this race has been touched by the blessing of God, according to the pronouncement of Noah long ago. So that's where he goes. He goes and he has the servant go in a place or to a place where they've heard something of the word of God. They heard something of what it is to worship God. And even though there were idolaters there, and the history of Rebekah shows this and so on, nevertheless, there is also God's holy seed among them. That's why he goes and or sends the servant to go there. Not among the Canaanites, only among the people who are blessed of God. The second thing is, Isaac himself may not go and live there. The bride has to be from his kindred, the Shemites, and the bride has to come back into Canaan. You see, the land, according to the promise of God, was very, very important. This is the promised land. That's why the chapter prior to this, he had Sarah buried in this land. Not back in the family graveyard in Haran or in Ur, but here in this new home, even the home, a picture of the paradise forever, even heaven. And so Isaac may not get a heathen wife. An unbelieving wife has to be a godly one, and also she must be brought to live with Isaac here. So that's how Abraham shows his faith here. And he also shows his faith by taking the lead. Abraham is a true head of the household. He was a head of Sarah. Sarah even would call him Lord. You realize that? And Peter? Sarah submitted to her husband Abraham. Abraham was not, of course, called to be a tyrant, but called to be a picture of Jesus Christ, who's the head of the church. And as the woman in the marriage is called to be the bride of this husband, and also a picture of the church submitting to Christ, she must submit to her husband in all things lawful. So Abraham here takes the lead also in the marrying of a child. Now, this is something that seems to be out of this world, or a relic of antiquity, that the husband and the father would actually have any say whatsoever in the marrying of children. Not only of daughters, you can maybe understand that, but of even the males in the family, and even the one who is 40 years old. Now, come on now. Isn't this, again, this relic of antiquity? This thing that doesn't fit here, it's a cultural thing? I think not, as we'll see presently. But I do want to say that this is part of the faithfulness of Abraham. And I don't know, we're not told this, I don't know if Abraham consulted with Isaac. I think he would. I think he would have. And I think, therefore, that Isaac would have consented to this and been waiting for this. Isaac is showing himself to be a man of God, and he's fully aware of what's going on in this sacred, sacred event. Just one more thing. When Abraham sends the servant off, he's a trusted servant. Whoever he may be, he's a trusted servant, an old and a wiser man. He's been with Abraham maybe a long time, who's also one of the covenant people, as he shows himself to be. And so solemn an event is this, that Abraham has the servant swear. Swear in the name of the triune God. Swear by putting his hand under the thigh of Abraham some way, some peculiar way of showing the solemnity of the situation. Of this I'll not venture to speak at this point, but it shows solemnity and also faith. The servant does this. This is a very important, very, very important event. And so they go. Now, do you want to say something of the piety of the servant? The servant here is sent on his way, and he has some questions about this, and he needs to be absolved of his oath if the woman's not willing to come back, and so on. But he swears that he will do as best he can as much as he can, and knowing the will of Abraham and the will of God. So he goes on his way, and this is a very wise and shrewd servant. We're not told that Abraham told him what to take or what to say at all. He is himself now on his own, as it were, but not really. In the light of the Word of God and the things that he's been taught, he is going forth here to find a bride for Isaac, and he goes to the place of Abraham's kindred, and he prays. He goes to the place where the women would come at evening time to get water at the well, verse 11, and he prays to the Lord God, Master of Abraham, who's his God. It's also the same God. And he prays that God would give success to his labors and show kindness to his master Abraham. It's not about him. It's not about the servant. He doesn't get a commission for this. He's just wanting that God would show his kindness to Abraham. And notice here how shrewd he is, how wise he is. He prays in such a way that the woman would show herself to be pious in the things that he prays might be displayed by this woman. He prays that the woman, the one woman who would come, who would draw water for himself not only, but for his camels, would be the one that would be the one for Isaac. And he prays that, no doubt, to have shown to him that here's a woman, not of the world, but of heaven. You see, women and men, a woman of heaven is a woman who's a servant. No matter what your capacity, where you're at, in the home or not, you're a servant. Just as men are to be, but this is your calling, to be a servant, a help to your husband not only, but if you're single, a help to God's kingdom, a servant. That is so very important. And Rebecca shows herself to be such, but more on that presently. But the man asks that this woman who comes would give him drink, but also for his 10 camels. Children, you know how much camels drink? Camels who've been perhaps for a long time in the desert, crossing to get to Haran, maybe they drink 20 to 40 gallons of water each camel. Multiply that times 10. It would take maybe some hours for the woman to draw water for all the camels. Well, certainly shows that this woman who might say, yeah, I'll draw water, and then do this, is someone who has industry and serving in her blood. And she does this to a stranger. She's showing hospitality. And she's showing as well when she says, oh yes, my house is open to you. I know that this will happen, that her household is something like Abraham's, a model of entertaining strangers, sometimes angels even, unawares. And so this is the faithfulness of Abraham and of this servant. And this is the faithfulness that he's showing with regard to his covenant obligations. And something here that is so beautiful. Abraham, remember, a covenant man. He is in the fellowship of God. And he's responding now to the love and the life and the friendship of God. And he's wanting to do the will of God. Beautiful. Now, I don't want to be too speculative here, but I do want us to remember there's theology in this. There's pictures here that are being drawn. And I think it's even a picture of what God himself does when he goes to get his bride for Jesus Christ, his son. Now, are you following me here? Abraham is a man of God. Isaac, as we've said, is the seed of the woman who is Jesus Christ, according to the book of Galatians. In Isaac will your seed be called. In Christ will the seed be called, Paul says, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. That means that it could very well be that Abraham is acting on behalf of the Father of Heaven here, who is getting this bride for his son, Jesus Christ. And here there is this solemnity about it, and God himself is entering into an oath. And I don't know who the servant represents here, but, and I speak as a man, and I may not be dogmatic about this, but could the servant who's nameless here be the Holy Spirit? And could it be that Isaac now, who's not even mentioned here, who has been to Mount Moriah and been sacrificed and been even risen from the dead, is the risen Christ? And now the Spirit is sent, and we have this in a picture of Abraham getting a wife for Isaac. The Spirit is sent, and this is God picturing for us that He is sending His Spirit to gather the church. Again, I speak as a man. All of that as a man. And I don't want to be dogmatic. But if Isaac is the Christ, and he's the son of Abraham here, God is represented here. And if this whole is a picture of redemptive history and how the church is gathered through the Son and through marrying the Son, there's something here of gospel. And be that as it may in the application here of this marrying of Isaac, there's certainly something for us men here and us families here to remember of the way of a man with a maid, of a way of the covenant for the continuation of God's covenant in our midst. This point, many would turn me off and say, Reverend Dick, I know what you're going to say here. The marriage of Isaac, in which he had hardly any say, and sight unseen of Rebekah, has got to be jettisoned from our midst. This is all about arranged marriages, isn't it? Can't be true. Well, however that may be, however much we think about this and object to the term arranged marriage, there's certainly something here that we need to take home, men. You men, if you would be a covenant man in your home, you lead the way in the marrying of your children. And you have a say, and you lead the way. And it's not, oh yeah, Dad, I met this chick the other night, and we're getting married next week, Thursday. No, that's not how it works. The man of the home is the authority also for the marrying of the children. And the children must honor this, the wife as well, in collaboration with the man is part of this, but the man is the ultimate authority here under God. And this is what we read in Father Abraham. This is where so many, even Christians, miss it. We raise our children in the fear of God. That's our responsibility in the covenant. They get to the age of puberty. We let them just play the field. We let them go out on the dates and so on. And modern American dating, which is the way of the heathen by and large, is what we do in Christian homes. And the father's out of it, and the mother's out of it. And see you, Dad, can I have the keys to the Chevy, and we're going on a date. Hold it a second. Is that pious, marrying? You see, here we are raising these precious seed and having baptized them in the name of the God of the covenant and the God of the promise to us and our children. And then they get to this age, we think they're mature enough and they can do this on their own, and we have no say in it, and we've not been leading them, and it's all a free-for-all. I don't understand that. The Bible teaches here that Abraham is an example in all things in which he shows his faith, and so, I believe, also in the marrying of his son Isaac. That's why the Apostle Paul himself would speak in 1 Corinthians of fathers giving their daughters in marriage. You know why we do that? Even unbelieving marriage ceremonies still have fathers giving away the bride. Isn't that amazing? It's amazing because it's so inconsistent what fathers do, even unbelieving fathers, but they give away the bride. It's a very sentimental moment. And there's fathers, and they come up marching up with the bride, and who gives this man to this woman in marriage, and so on. They say, her mother and I do. Well, that is biblical. And it's all because, really, at least the daughters are the property of the dads. You belong to your dad, and no man can take you. No. The father gives the daughter away. Now, here's Isaac. And he, even here, we're not going to go into that, but Abraham is supervising this marriage of Isaac, the man, here. So you have something of father involvement, father piety here, father prayer, father concern that there not be a wife of the heathen, and father concern that it not be just any old woman, it be someone who's a believer who can come and worship with Isaac. Someone that we would seek as a mate for our children with whom we could worship. And so it's not just any old one who says they're a believer. Not even that. It won't be that just any of the sons of Shem, any of the carnal sons of Shem are good enough, or daughters are good enough. Rebecca has to show she's godly. She has to show that the fruit of the Holy Spirit is in her. And then she has to respond to this wonderful providence of God and say, I will go. And that leads to my second point here. There's this wonderful, wonderful divine provision here. The servant prays, and God, while he's speaking, sends Rebecca. And the servant has prayed, Lord, show me the one you have appointed, and indeed the one that God had appointed, Rebecca, comes right away. Fulfills all of the stipulations of the prayer of the servant of Abraham, and there it is. It's amazing. This amazing provision of God, of this wife for Isaac, and all, over the many miles, and we don't know just how long this took, but certainly the servant was thinking upon this, and he was in the Holy Spirit, if not representing the Holy Spirit of God, finding a bride whom God had already determined and led right to the well. There it is. And this is the wonderful gospel of God finding the bride for his son. It's right here. And of this, we are dogmatic and we declare. The truth is, God finds a bride for his son, Jesus. That's the truth right here. He does this according to his appointment. He finds you. Do you know that? Are you found yet by God? Are you discovered by God, as it were, discovered in your sins and on your knees repenting and now believing in God? This is the message here. God is pursuing a bride for his precious Son of the promise who represents Jesus Christ. And that's the gospel here. God pursues a bride, a church, his elect, for his Son Jesus. Glorious. And of this we can be confident too. Do you know that? As people of God and as fathers and mothers, young people, older people, been wanting to get married maybe for a while, haven't seen one come along. God has one. This we can be assured of if it's his will that you be married. Now there's something here that we ought to remember. And that's this, that we live in a broken world. Now, who needs to remind you of that, you say, let alone a preacher? We live in a broken world. And godly fathers are rare. They are. Many are the broken homes, and many are the children of God who are called out of broken homes, and women and men. And what? We don't have a godly father. Well, you do have a godly father in heaven. That's the point of all religion, remember that. And there is a way that God gives for us to be marrying in the Lord and to find the right mate and that is in the Church of Jesus Christ, which is full of fathers and mothers and grandfathers and mentors and people who can step up and take the place of fathers who should have done their work and been pious. This is how God provides for each and every one he intends to see married. But here, this is a wonderful, wonderful provision, and it's recognized, and this is my final point here. This is known. There's a provision here of God that is known. The servant sees it. Before he finishes speaking, Rebecca is come, and the servant is getting excited, and he runs to meet her, and he verifies that, yes, this is indeed the one. And in verse 26 and 27, he worships God. He sees that this is clear. This is what God has done. He's answered the prayer that I have made. He's fulfilling his covenant promise. And the young woman then, she runs and she goes to her mother's household and tells these things to them. And Laban and Bethuel, they recognize the providence of God. And they say, this is of God. And you can read of that narrative, the rehearsing of this all by the servant in Bethuel's house and Laban's house. And they are amazed. And they say, yes, we can't do a thing about it. Take Rebecca. It's obviously that God has led you here and God is fulfilling his promise and he's blessing Abraham, your master, dear servant. So they recognize this. Not only that, Rebecca recognizes this. And here you have something of the consent of the woman. She is asked not necessarily to consent to the marriage, but she is asked afterwards if she would go right away with the servant. And so what happens is the brother and the mother, they want the young woman, Rebecca, to stay. Verse 55, a few days, maybe at least 10, after she may go. And the servant is so urgent about the Lord's business, he says, do not hinder me, since the Lord has prospered my way. Send me away so that I may go to my master. And so they said, we'll call the young woman and ask her personally. And so they're getting her consent. They called Rebecca and said to her, will you go with this man? And here's one of the most amazing words and statements of this whole narrative. She says, I will go. Sight unseen. Which of you women would go that way? Sight unseen. Well, Isaac's the same way. Sight unseen, he will receive this bride. But I think that says something here about the faith of this whole thing. Do you know, with marriage, young people, you older folks, you married folks, you don't have to listen. But everybody else does. I always do that because I know everybody's going to listen anyway. This is about faith. Marrying is about faith. To believe in God is to believe in God. No, you can't see him. To believe that God is leading you to a mate and maybe that this is the one or what has to do with faith. And discerning in a woman, men, or in a man, ladies, virtues from heaven. Being a servant, being beautifully adorned with the righteousness of Christ, being meek. That's, men, what you look for in a woman. And ladies, that's what you want to be. And ladies, what you look for in a man is a humble man of God. You look in for him to be a servant. You look for one who's not desperate, not aching so much so that he just can't live without a woman and it's taking the place of his religion. You don't want to be that way, men. Seek the kingdom first. And you women too, you seek the kingdom first. And then through faith, God assures you of the one. That's how that works. It's a mystery. The way of a man with a maid is a mystery. This is how it works. This is how we are assured. As we come together, seeking the kingdom of heaven together, having the Father's approval and the knowledge of people and the family of God and on and on. This is how God leads us. You note here, this is a miraculous providence, obviously. But God does something similar in our own lives. Which of you men and which of you ladies who've been married maybe 50 years would not say that it was a miracle and wisdom of God that God led you to just this one? We think about our marriages and we say, yeah, we've had some hard goes and so on. She's not perfect. He's not perfect. That's just the one. Just the one. And we're prospering in the Lord because God sent us just the one. We've made all mistakes, but God never does. There's assurance here. And the assurance of faith. And this is why we need to preach a faith whereby we can be assured and not leave people in doubt either of their salvation or anything. Anything. Even with regard to a mate. When Isaac is coming out and meditating in the field, lifting up his eyes in verse 64, Rebekah lifts up her eyes. The romance is about to culminate. Romance from afar. This wasn't a letter writing thing either, or internet dating. This was faith's romance. Receiving now the provision of God, she sees Isaac. She dismounts from her camel in respect, veils herself, covers herself. The servant had told Isaac then everything that he'd been done. He's assured, this is the one. And Isaac brings Rebekah to his mother Sarah's tent, and he took Rebekah. They're married now. She becomes his wife, and he loved her. He loved her. Isn't that something? Everybody nowadays is wondering, where is love? And love is at the center of all the romances and the serial dating of our world. I got to know that I love this person. Well, Sarah or Rebekah and Isaac didn't have to know that. That's fun. That's interesting. All they had to do was believe. And people of God and young people and those who aren't so young, whatever, may not be married, know this. All you have to do is believe. That's the calling. Believe in God. The love will follow. The lovey-doveyness will follow. The romance will follow. Don't say, I need to be in love. If you need to be in love, you're going to get out of love. You need to be in God, in the fellowship of God and faith. That's the point. And here, in this sacred event, in the continuation of the covenant, there needs to be faith and acknowledging the provision of God. And Church of Jesus Christ, when our Lord comes to you, He works faith. Then we love Him. Then we are comforted with our only comfort in life and in death as the bride of Jesus Christ. And then we know that everything is going to be all right. Not only, but will be a blessing. Whether we're single, whether we're married, just the right time, just according to Father's will, just so that in the generations there will be a covenant people, a Christ people, and a credo, a believing people. That's what this is for, moving on. So that we can continue to be children of Abraham, children of God. In the generations, dear ones, do you realize that at stake is the promises of God in our midst? And I don't want to say that that's tenuous, but in the way you see of responsible parenting, responsible marrying, carrying on the banner lifted high of God with us, that's what we learn here. That's what we learn about prayer and urgency and learning not just how they do it out there. Though we be called archaic, though we be called regimental, though we be called those who are missing out on all the fun, last I knew of it, Christianity was about holiness and true joy and a lot of fun. only if it's about holiness and joy. So, let's carry on. Amen. Lord God, we do pray that you would bless what we said, Lord, forgives what's said and heard amiss. But Lord, may the Word of God be powerful, even almighty, to work the continuation of covenant in our midst. May it be, Lord, that we and our children are one family and would promote the family of God so that we can declare to the world there's a God who's a Father. And there's a wonderful Holy Spirit who's a comforter, and there's a Son who's a Son of our love, even Jesus, whom to know is life eternal. And bless, Lord, that the young people and those who are a little older, and they marry, may marry in the Lord, and behold what you do from their loins even, calling as many as you shall call. God bless us all. We are weak, but you are strong. We are in need. You are the God who provides a wife for Isaac, a wife for our children. You provide the bride for your Son. In Jesus' name, amen. Number 36 in the hymnal is our last Psalter hymnal. Let's sing 36, not only 4, but also 1. 1 and 4 of 36. Receive God's benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Thank you for tuning in to this broadcast of Sovereign Grace United Reformed Church. Sovereign Grace Church, served by the ministry of Reverend Mitchell Dick, worships each Lord's Day at 9:30 a.m. and 5:30 p.m. at the chapel of Piper College, located at 3333 East Beltline Northeast between 3 Mile and 4 Mile Roads. You are most cordially welcome to join us for worship or visit us online at www.sgurc.org or contact us by phone at 616-406-8562. It is our prayer that the Lord would add His indispensable blessing to this ministry in order that His name would be glorified through the edification of His people and the translation of sinners out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of His dear Son,